Hello everyone, Amod here from Retarget Common YouTube channel, and I am here with another topic in this episode. So the topic we are going to cover in this particular video is called default values in this episode. So you might not get what actually I am going to teach you here. So before going to concept, let's do some practical and see what actually we have some default values. Okay, so what I am going to do, let me go to the repo where we are writing the code, and let me go to src. Okay, so what I will do, let me copy this create booking. Okay, so here you can see this I have created long back while covering the video on like on how to hit the post request in this episode. So there I have written this particular lines of code. Now I'm creating a copy of this code or this class file, sorry, Java file. So let me name as like with default values. Okay, so let me open that copied file where it is. Okay, with default values. Okay, so here let me remove unwanted comments here so that we can see everything in one line. Let me remove this part as well. Okay, and let me remove this also. Okay, I've already explained these lines of code well in previous videos. So if you have not watched, please go and watch, because then only you'll understand what actually we are doing here. Okay. So here you should see that we are creating the request specification where I am putting like I want to have base URI, something base path, right? And then we have body and all. So, and if you run it, then in log we'll see everything properly, right? Means what are the base URI, base path, even it will print, because we are using log.all for both request and response. So here, see it clearly, we have request URI, okay? Because we have passed the base URI and base path, so the final URI has been created using by combining both base URI and base path. Okay, what I'm going to do here, I will comment this one. Okay, both base URI and base path. Okay, so means I'm not passing where is my endpoint. Okay, so let's see what happens when you run now. Okay, so let me run it again. And let's see what is the output. Okay, so okay, we got some error, obviously we'll get it. So can you see here request method proper, because we are calling anyway, but can you see the request URI? It's taking local host on the port 8080. Okay, so 8080 you must have heard, like when we start Jenkins and also many applications start by default on 8080 port only, right? Obviously we can change the HTTP ports if you want, but here we can see when we have not passed base URI and base path, it is taking some local host, right? So means whenever, like suppose you have, if you are practicing Jira or if you practice on Jenkins, right? So generally we install on our system. So we generally access using the local host and with the port number where it is installed. Similarly, we are seeing up here. So what is actually happening when you don't pass base URI and base path, so automatically recessor will point, okay? Or recessor have some default values which will automatically point to your local host with the default port. So this might be useful if you have installed or if you are running your API endpoints locally on your server, okay? Locally on your machine. That time this particular base URI and base path would work. Okay, so generally it happens, you can like suppose whenever you're testing any application, so that application you can install on your local system as well, right? So similar kind of things here, API also you can run or you can use that one on your local machine itself, right? So in that case it would work. Now the question is how it is giving with the base URI and base path local host, from where it is taking. So the answer is, in this class, we have some static variables, okay? We have some static variables which has been assigned some default values, okay? So what I will do, let me go to this resource class. Okay, let you go to this resource class and let you maximize this code. So here you can see there are so many static final variables we have. Like generally you can see this default URI. Okay, then default body root path, default port. Okay, default path. So we you not understand everything, but you can see we have so many public static final variables with some default values. So here you can see this one base URI, right? When you're not passing this base URI, okay, so this will be actually default URI. So what is default value? Default URI localhost, right? And when you don't pass the port, right? When you don't pass the port, then it will be equal to undefined port, which is evaluated to default port, right? 8080. So we know that final URI will be built or derived from by combining both base URI and base path, right? So there, since we have not passed base URI and base path, automatically they are using some default values to it. Okay, so this is not a very big concept in our Chainium framework or some web automation framework. We generally have some variables, okay, class level variables, okay, which you can access it anywhere. Okay, that depends upon whether you want to create static or non-static. That depends upon your requirement. Okay, so similarly, this system also provides some public static final variables with the default values. Okay, so now you can ask me what is the purpose of it? Why we are going to use it actually? So leave over the resource code. Simple thing. Suppose you have an application and that application has something user name and password to log in. Okay, and it will have some username as well. Right? Suppose username is Amod Mahajan 123, but actual name is Amod Mahajan, and I will have some password. Okay, so generally you people can store in some external files like properties file, JSON files, Excel sheet, wherever you can store, or you can create some interface as well, right? Interface or class where you can go and store these values. Okay, and generally we declare those values as static so that we can use it anywhere. Okay, without worrying about the reference, null point, exception, or no need to worry about that. Use the class name dot, then you can access the static variables. So that is the advantage. Suppose you have one class where you have set all the values, you want to use any class, you can go and use that. You can call that particular variables from that interface or class, whatever you have. Same thing it is here. Same for same purpose here we have. Okay. So what is the meaning of that? Okay. So let me go and run or write some code so that you can understand. Okay. So what I'll do. I'll create a new class called default values one. Okay. What I'm going to do here, let me maximize this again. Okay. What I'll do, let me create two tests. Okay. Let me create two tests. Okay. Public. Void, then create booking one. Okay, create booking one. And let me copy the same code here. Where? From without default values. Okay, so I'll copy this code. Okay, and I will put it here. Okay, simple. So let me uncomment these things. Okay, so here I have uncommented everything. Okay, perfect. What I'll do, again, same get booking two with some different payload. Okay. Okay, so I will simply change like total price something, and it will be Amod one, Mahajan one, right? So one thing you should notice, like we have repeated numbers on good lines of code, right? Because we have this base URI, base path here also. Okay, so body might be different because we are running for different payloads, but that's fine, right? And then we are repeating the status code as well. Verification, you can see we are verifying the status code. So you from if you have watched my previous videos, then you must know that we can use some request and response specifications here so that we can reduce the repeated lines of code. Okay, because I always like the principle DIY, dry principle, don't repeat yourself. Okay, DIY generally means for do it yourself, right? So it's dry principle, don't repeat yourself. Okay, so there's another way as well. Okay, another way also we can do. What we can do here, we can have one before class. Okay, before class annotation from TSNG, and let me create public void setup. Okay, so what you can do here, in this SSL class, we know that we have a static variable called base URI. Okay, this is base URI. So what I'll do, I'm going to copy this URI and paste it here. Okay, you should notice here, since the base URI is static variable, okay, this is a base URI static variable. So once we are setting up the value, it will be there always, right? That is the meaning of static here. Okay, that is generally Java concept. Whenever you're initializing, it will be initialized, right? Because it doesn't belong to an object. It is at class level. So all the objects will share. Okay. Similarly, what you can do, this is your dot base path, right? And what I'll do in base path, I will copy this one. Okay. Okay. What I can do, I can remove the lines of code now. Okay, I can remove these lines of code. Okay, basically because these are the static variables which we can set at before class level. Okay, let me run. So we know that before class annotation will run before running any test method. Okay, so means in this particular class we have two test methods, right? So before running these two test method, this will run. Then it will not run for each test. Okay, it will run only once. Okay, and what I can do, I can put one sysout in setup. Okay, just to show you that it is running only once. So let me run it. Okay, why I'm getting, okay, maybe I imported at test notation from JUnit. Okay, so be sure from where you're importing. Okay, so let me run it now. Okay, let me maximize the console. And you can see in setup, right? In setup we have, then you can see it is picking the request URI from the static variable. Okay, same thing here as well. Right, and obviously if you have multiple test method which are using different base path, you can always override that. Okay, because once you are changing, it will be changed for everyone. Okay, that's why because it's a static, so you need to be sure that if you are changing, it will impact everywhere. So be sure what you are changing. Okay, so you can go on some extended view level also, right? Suppose when you have multiple classes, okay, like suppose default value, suppose you have this test or that test, right? So instead of creating this before class, you can create go for before test or before suite, so that at the beginning only everything will be set. So that you know there's no need to declare that base URI again and again or any static variables. Once you declare, in the appropriate annotation, you can go for it. Even you can group it. Like suppose this particular default value one is only responsible for create booking. Some other class will have some like suppose update booking, this one test cases, or some will delete booking test cases. So you can group, okay? You can group based on your functionality as well. And you can set the value whatever you want, okay? So just to show you again, what I'll do, I will copy this one with default values, okay? and I get another 2. Okay, so let me go to 2 here. Okay, what I'll do here? Sorry, I do not. I want to copy this one. Default values. Okay. What I can do here in default value 1, let me copy it. Okay. So default value 2 we have, right? Default value 2 we have. So what I'll do, I will remove the before class from here. Okay, before class from here. And in the first class, instead of before class, I will make it before taste or before sweet. Whatever you want to do, you can do. Okay, before taste. Okay. And inside here, what I'll do, I will go and generate the authentication token. Okay, so RESTful Booker. Okay, so let me copy the body. To copy the body here. Okay, and we know that the base path will not be booking, right? So I just want to override it. Okay, means I want to pass my value. So what is that base path? Auth here. Okay, let me done for it. And let me delete this book. In this particular class, I will have only one paste. Okay, and once we generate, so it give me 200 only, right? Okay, let me remove unwanted unused import. Okay, so now we have two classes, default value 1 and default value 2. Okay, so we have some output problem here. Okay, no problem. So default value 1 and default value 2. So here I am not setting any base path. Okay, but in default value 1 class, we have set up this one, right? So what I can do, I can create a tsng.xml using these two classes. So let me go to tsng, go to convert to tsng. Okay, and let me name it default values. Okay, and let me finish it. So let me go to tsng.xml, and you can see here we have one test. Okay, we have one test, this test tag, right? And okay, so okay, not this tsng.xml, we have tsng default values XML, right? So here we can see we have one test tag, okay, and we have two classes, default value 1 and default value 2. Okay, so always remember, if your test class consists of add test annotated method, then only those classes will come here. Okay, and you should see in default value 1 we have before test, right? When this particular setup method will execute only once they are start executing these classes. Okay, that is the meaning of before test. It's not add test annotated method, no. Okay, before test represents the test tag in the XML. Okay, let me run this particular XML and see the output. Okay, let me maximize it. We can see it is in setup. Okay, it is in setup. It is in setup, right? And then we have booking. Okay, here you can see Amod and Mahajan we have passed. And let me go to the another request, another test method, right? Here we have Amod 1 and Mahajan 1, right? Remember, these have passed. And let's see the auth 1, right? So here you can see, right? And we are overriding the base path. It is going the auth here. Okay, so this is the advantage when you are setting this static variables, so that you can use it. Okay, you will not get a null point exception or some local host by default, will not problem there. Okay, so this default value helps you to set the value. Okay, set the common values at one place so that you can use it, or actually RESTful automatically uses that one. Okay, there's no need to call this as a base or again and again. No, just you set at one, set at one place, and everywhere you can use it. Okay. And the what is the base thing I like, that you can even set the request specification and response specification as well. Okay. So what is meaning of that actually? Okay. if you see here, if we go to default value one, right? And here we have static variables, this is dot equity specification. You can see here you can directly store whatever request we are creating, right? Again, we know that request specification can help us to reduce the duplicate lines of code. You just simply create the request specification and assign it here. Okay, you can same thing you can do. Same thing you can do for response specification as well, right? So as of now, I'm putting the null, but you can create and you can put it here. So if you have not seen the previous video where I have explained how to create request specification and response specification, then you must go and see how actually it works. Okay, or just to give some example, like suppose I want to share some request specification which are common, right? So what I'll do, this is should dot given, right? And I want to print the log dot all. Simple, okay? Simple, small specification I've created. So you can remove these lines of code. Okay? And similarly, in the response, I want to verify the status code. This is your dot expect dot status code 200, okay? So you can remove this lines of code as well. Okay, here also you can remove this lines of code. Okay, here as well. Remember, in response specification, you cannot put the log at all. Okay, so if I run this particular lines of code again, so it will work perfectly fine. You can see it is logging and it is verifying the status call and everything. Right. You can see the request details, right? These are coming from your default request specification. Okay, this is going because we are setting up here. Okay, so the static variables will help in the same way we generally use in our framework. Okay, whatever you want to set, simply we set it. Similar things, this also provides you some default static variables, okay, with some default values as well. You should go and really use those things because it would really help you to declare at one place and use it anywhere. Okay, that is the again the major concept behind using the static variables. Okay, so I hope this should help you, and this is really good when you actually develop the framework and you don't want to have data at multiple places. Okay, so I hope this would be good for you, and that's it in this video. We'll learn another new topic in this episode in next video. Thank you everyone. But still, if you have any doubt, you can always comment on my video and I will try my best to help you. Thank you everyone.